Welcome to tonight's Dazzle Unlimited. I'm Steve Steinberg, Surrey's host. I'm here in Stockholm, Sweden. It's middle of December, 2008, and I have with me a very special guest, Nobel Prize winner, on a topic of great importance, I think, to us all. She is Dr. Françoise Barré-Sinoussi, and she shares the prize for the discovery of HIV. Let's get to that discussion right now. Your title.
Regulation of Retroviral Infection Unit at the Pasteur Institute
in France. And you are this year's 2008 joint Nobel Prize winner in the area of physiology and medicine.
That's right. Yes.
And what you, with your colleague Dr. Luc Montagnier, jointly received this aspect of the prize for was the discovery of human immunodeficiency virus, HIV. Mm-hmm. Can you briefly go into the story of how you came upon this discovery, which since then, of course, has become world-shaking and means so much to the prognoses for developing cures or at least therapies for people who have this global encircling illness?
We have to go back in 1981 when the disease itself was recognized in the United States. In the West Coast, with a few patients that were all with the same symptoms, a profound immune depletion of their T cells, and as a consequence, opportunistic infection, mostly for the first one, pneumonia due to Pneumocystis carini. And a few months after, the first cases were recognized in France by clinicians. And they came to us at Pasteur to ask whether we will be interested to look for retrovirus in this disease. Why they ask us? It's because we were at the Pasteur Institute, Professor Montagné, myself, and Jean-Claude Sherman, specialized in studying retroviruses in mammalian. We were at the time that the only human retrovirus that was discovered was HTLV-1, human T leukemia virus.
Which dated back how far?
Oh, it was at the end of the 70s that this virus was isolated and identified. But we knew on animal models that retroviruses are present in almost all species. And they were mostly associated to leukemia and cancer. Mm-hmm. And we were among the rare scientists in the world, I will say, to continue to work on the relationship between retroviruses and cancer. So the reason why they came to us, because some virologists at the hospital used to study at the Pasteur Institute, and they knew that our group was working on this family of viruses.
And from that point, what was the challenge to you for that led you to the discovery of the HIV virus?
First, we said, look, it's really possible that a virus of this family could be responsible because of the first virus that I just mentioned, HTLV, that infect preferentially T cells. And the disease, AIDS, was characterized by T-cell immune deficiency. The second thing that we knew as retrovirologists that in cats, feline leukemia virus caused leukemia, of course, in cats. But very often cats are dying from immune deficiency before they develop leukemia.
Uh-huh.
So, of course, since we were working on these family of viruses, we had all the technology to grow this family of virus and to detect this family of virus characterized by a specific enzyme, the reverse transcriptase. The enzyme is required for copying, transforming RNA into DNA. This is a very important issue. Without this transformation, there is no virus replication.
Mm-hmm.
So we had in our hand the technology, and we said, why not? We can look. And especially at that time, we were also in our lab interested in looking whether retroviral sequences could be associated with breast cancer, and we were looking for retroviral sequences in lymphocytes. So that means that indeed we knew also how to isolate lymphocytes and put in culture. So it's mainly because of the technology that we had in hand, and also the expertise on retroviruses that we say, okay, let's look.
But along those lines, did you find any key obstacles that maybe you were headed down a certain path that you were sure would lead to an answer and something, whether in your research or maybe politically, economically, said, wait a minute, you can't quite go there, or not just now, or not just this way?
No, not at the beginning. I mean, working at Pasteur Institute, we are quite free, I must say, to select on what project we would like to work. And at the beginning, it was just a very first test to say, okay, we will receive a sample from one patient, and I think the discussion with the clinician were crucial in deciding to take patient lymph nodes instead of taking blood, because we said, okay, if we take a blood sample from a patient with AIDS, you are telling us, clinicians, that there is no more CD4 cells in AIDS. So if the virus is in CD4 cells, and we believe that the virus should be in CD4 cells, it's not the best time to look for the virus in blood if there are no more cells.
So in the lymph nodes, you would
find
more.
So the reason the clinicians said before they have a lymph nodes, generalized lymph node, and he proposed to us to have a lymph node biopsy from one patient that he was thinking will accept to participate to the research. And so that was the first discussion, was really in December 1982.
Mm-hmm.
The first sample arrived at Pasteur beginning January 1983, and 2 weeks after, we had in the culture the first sign of retroviral enzyme activity. So it was very fast, okay?
Yeah, 2 weeks is amazing.
It was only 2 weeks. I mean, of course, that was not sufficient to prove that the virus was the cause of AIDS, but to isolate the virus, it was really quick.
Well, what was the next step that led
to? The next step was, of course, to make sure that we will be able to keep the virus in culture, because when we got the enzyme activity, we immediately found out that the cells were dying. So we had to react very quickly and rush at the blood bank that we had at the time across the street and ask for a blood donor. And if we could have blood from a blood donor, and we add the lymphocyte from the blood donor into the culture, and again we saw the same phenomenon, reverse transcriptase activity in the culture, and again cell death. That was the first evidence, I will say, that the virus itself was responsible for the death of T cells in culture. Then we had to characterize a little bit more of this virus and to see whether we could be sure that it was a retrovirus, whether the morphology in electron microscopy was looking similar to what we knew about retroviruses. And we did that with Charlie Duguay and found out that the morphology was the typical size of a retrovirus, envelope particle like retroviruses, budding particle at the surface of the lymphocyte like retrovirus are budding viruses, but the shape of the core was not the same shape at all as the one that we used to see for HTLV, for example, or for classical tumor viruses. So we say this is something bizarre.
Something new.
Something bizarre and new. New because we did not immediately thought about a subfamily of retrovirus that was known in animals, in sheep or in horse, for example, called lentiviruses. Mm-hmm. And but later on, I think it was April, May, we realized that was really the shape, the same morphology of this subfamily of viruses known as lentiviruses.
You published, of course, at the time.
Yeah, so we published in May 1983 the first characteristic of this virus. And of course, we could not say yet that this virus was the cause of it. We just report the virus isolated from a first patient, having the characteristic of a new retrovirus. We report also that the cross-reactivity with the first human retroviruses known at that time, HTLV, was weak, very weak, or absent. That was also a strong argument to think that this virus was new. And then, May 1983, we rushed to try to isolate viruses from other patients with AIDS, with pre-AIDS symptoms, show that we were always able to isolate the virus from these patients, but never from patients with other disease, like cancer, like autoimmune disease, or blood donors. We also isolate the virus from patients at risk for AIDS, other homosexual patients, and also we isolate the virus from a woman and her lovers, and they were both with AIDS. And we say, okay, it's clearly a relationship between this virus and the disease. And in addition, we started to make a large epidemiological survey to see whether population or patient groups of patients at risk for AIDS or with AIDS had antibody against our virus and were not presenting antibody against other viruses. And that was really done, let's say, in September 1983. So during the first months, let's say, between May 1983 and the end of 1983, we accumulate data that were all going in the same direction, indicating that the virus was the cause of AIDS.
This is Steve Steinberg speaking. I hope that you're finding value in tonight's episode of Dazzle Unlimited. If you'd like to comment on tonight's topic, or if your company might wish to advertise on the Dazzle Unlimited television series, please let us know. You can email us at dazzle@dazzleunlimited.com. Remember, Dazzle Unlimited airs in Southern Manhattan on Time Warner Cable TV Channel 35 every Wednesday evening in prime time at 8:30 p.m. Please make a note of it. And now, back to tonight's episode of Dazzle Unlimited.
Accumulate data that were all going in the same direction, indicating that the virus was the cause of AIDS.
What was the world reaction to that finding at that time?
That was when the difficulty arrived. I mean, it was difficult to convince the scientific community that the virus was the cause of it. Not only the scientific community, I will say even the public, even the politician, even the patients themselves. They were saying, oh, but maybe it's an opportunistic agent. They said, no, it's not an opportunistic agent, because really the virus is associated each time to the disease itself or to patients that still do not have opportunistic infection yet, but they are at risk for it. So certainly it was several months that were difficult to try to convince, and the reason why we made our best to accumulate all criteria to prove that it was a relationship between the virus and the disease. And among them, for example, in collaboration with people at the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, we isolated the virus from a donor, a blood donor, that was with AIDS, and with the recipient of this donor that was not with AIDS at the beginning, but finally developed AIDS.
Uh-huh.
And the two viruses were clearly related. So, I mean, it's this kind of evidences that really we accumulate during a year, let's say. And then in May 1984, it was a confirmation of the data by the American group, Bob Gallo, laboratory.
In the United States, during that general era when Reagan was president, I recall there was a lot of political resistance to the idea of HIV or AIDS even being an illness that could be transmitted amongst people regardless of gender or sexual proclivity. It was assumed it was purely a homosexually transmitted illness, something to do with their genetic makeup or something like this. What was your reaction to that kind of attitude at the time?
Of course, we thought that this was a crazy attitude, because I remember the time that even one American newspaper, I read that the French group isolated the virus responsible for homosexuality. I could not believe it. Of course, we already had under our eyes the fact that hemophiliacs were affected by the disease because they were receiving contaminated blood derivative. We had under our eyes, I just mentioned before, that we isolated the viruses from Africans, and they were not homosexual. We started to see what was going on indeed in the African continent. As you know, in France, we have quite a lot of immigrants from Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And at the hospital, we were able to see already patients from Africa with AIDS, and they were infected by heterosexual roots.
What I understand is that AIDS, and for the last several years at least, has been unfortunately sweeping Africa. And there's something of a comeback I've been reading about of AIDS in Scandinavia and Europe. It's quantify the current situation and give any recommendations as to what people need to be aware of to bring that level down again, or to get more medical research and activity in the area.
First of all, we know that today there is 33 million of people living with HIV/AIDS all over the world.
33 million?
33 million of people living with HIV/AIDS. So it's very important. Of course, more than 90% of those people are mostly in, I would not say Africa, are more countries.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And that's not only Africa, it's the situation in Asia. The situation is more and more frightening in Central Europe and Eastern Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Africa, the situation is, it depends on the country, of course, but it's more or less stabilizing compared to before.
Why is it stabilizing?
First of all, because it was probably the overestimate of numbers in Africa, first. Secondly, in some countries, at least in Africa, it has been HIV, strong HIV/AIDS program with education, information of the population, with the concrete results. Let me give an example. Uganda, at one time, when the government decided to have a program for information, education, counseling of the population, also distribution of condom, because we can protect against this infection by using condom. Mm-hmm. It turned out that they decreased the prevalence of infection of 50%.
Oh, that's huge.
Before access to antiretroviral treatment, 50% reduction of the prevalence of infection. So we know that prevention through information, education, counseling, use of condom can work. So it's probably those reasons that explain why there is more or less a stabilization, overestimation, prevention programs, and now starting to have access to antiretroviral treatment. It's too early to say that antiretroviral treatment is more or less a prevention measure, but we have already indication that treating the patients is not only a benefit at individual level, but it's also a benefit at collective level, since when you treat a patient, you reduce the viral load in the blood, but not only in the blood, at the level of genital secretion. Uh-huh. That means that the patients are less transmitting the virus to partners.
So the chance of transmission is decreased.
It's decreasing by the antiretroviral treatment. So it's too early in Africa or in poor countries to say that we have an impact of antiretroviral treatment on the epidemic. But we studies are going on to follow the situation since the start of access to antiretroviral treatment in poor countries. I mean, several of us are quite convinced that we will have a decrease of infection through usage of treatment.
What's the situation briefly in the United States, for example?
In the United States, to my knowledge, the situation is it's quite stable, and the incidence of infection is much lower, of course, than in developing countries. However, we know since some time that the homosexual population is starting again to be infected.
Uh-huh.
We have the same situation in Europe.
That's what I was hearing and reading. Is that due to public diminished public awareness of the problem?
Certainly, diminution of public awareness, and also, I will say, probably the fact that there is treatment. It's not a curative treatment, but you know, the information in the public is that, oh look, it's not so bad. Today we can be treated for HIV.
But that's expensive and it's a difficult treatment.
It's expensive, it's a difficult treatment. It could be long-term complication, escape to treatment in some patients if they are not adherent. But all of this information are not well understood. And I even wonder if the public is informed about all the complications of the treatment. So still, my message is, it's still a lot to do concerning information, education of the public, even at the era of antiretroviral treatment, because HIV is still there and it's still a problem. Imagine that if the young population have the same attitude than homosexual, we will start again a new epidemic in our population in the United States or in Europe.
What would your recommendations now, for our final question or so, be for medical research in this area? Where should it go? What kind of support should it have? And what would you recommend that people who are watching this show should keep in mind about HIV, AIDS, and how to deal with it?
I would recommend first, I will answer the last part of your question. I will first recommend to people, now that we have a treatment, even if it's not a cure, please do not hesitate to go for HIV testing.
Mm-hmm.
First step. Because very often, today, people that are infected are tested as infected too late.
Too late?
Yes. Because they don't go, they don't think that they are carrying the virus.
Is there some indication they should look for to say to the, so they can say to themselves, I might have a problem, I'm not really sure, maybe I better get tested?
We all are at risk, okay, of HIV.
So it should be a standard thing, go
to
the doctor?
So, I mean, people, young people, if they had sexual, non-protected sexual relationship, they should say, okay, let's make a test. Now, regarding research, what are the priorities today? I will say, first priority, go back to basic science.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we want to develop new therapeutic and vaccine strategy, clearly we need to understand better the early events after exposure to the virus in the body. We need to understand better what mechanisms are required to induce protective immunity. Even at the level of the mucosa, it's a sexually transmitted disease. And the immunity at the level of the mucosa is not very well known. Second message, we have to understand better what's going on in those very few people that are infected, but control naturally their infection. They are called HIV controllers. We know more and more precisely the mechanism, then we can think about inducing this mechanism by a therapeutic vaccine, for example.
Very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us. You've been watching Dazzle Unlimited. I wish there were more time, but I think we covered some good ground here. Again, I want to thank my very special guest, Dr. Françoise Barré-Sinoussi, Nobel Prize winner in physiology and medicine, along with her colleagues, Dr. Harald Zurhausen and Dr. Luc Montagnier, December 2008. I'm Steve Steinberg, reporting from Stockholm, Sweden. See you next time on another Dazzle Unlimited. Good night.
Start Heart Walk is coming to your area. Bring your family, bring your friends. Start something in your community and help save the lives of others. Join the movement and help fund research to fight heart disease and stroke. Start walking. Start something. Call 1-800-AHA-USA1 to find a Start Heart Walk near you or log on to heart.org/heartwalk to register.